about 27 to 40 million people around the globe. And this is men, women, and children. This is a $150 billion industry. There is more money to be made here than in any other industry, save for arms dealing. With a child, you can sell them thousands upon thousands of times. Because obviously people who want to keep this industry alive and active and out of the sight of normal Americans, they were feeling the threat. The way that the United States has set up their policies, they are engaging, really helping a multi-billion dollar industry flourish. And then also looking at the role of technology like artificial intelligence and how that actually warps or can contribute to the perversion of the family and even of the creation of a child. What happens when parents are no longer conceiving or procreating their children, but instead are making them and designing them in a lab? Are we actually creating a child that is unlike us? I think one of the primary aspects of being human, of being a woman, right, is to become a mother, a literal mother through childbirth, a figurative mother through the relationships that you have, really embodying Mother Mary and like the image of the church and what it means to be human.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today on today's episode of the Dr. J Show is Emma Waters. Emma is a research associate with the DeVos Center for Life, Religion, and Family at the Heritage Foundation. And she and I are going to discuss the rather sad and sorry business of child sex trafficking, some of the factors that go into it, some of the things that you may have heard from the movie, The Sound of Freedom, and some of the things you may have heard about the movie. So we'll be looking at this from a little bit more public policy angle. We don't have a narrative story in the same way that The Sound of Freedom did, but we'll be touching on a lot of those same issues. Emma Waters, thank you for joining me on the Dr. J Show.
Of course. Thank you for having me today.
Well, it's great to get acquainted with you. It was your column at the Daily Signal that we saw on this topic, on sex trafficking, that came to our attention, and that's how we got to know you and a little bit about your work at the Heritage Foundation. Can you just give us kind of the big picture highlights of the whole problem of sex trafficking in general and child sex trafficking in particular?
Yes. So globally, we know that trafficking is a $150 billion industry that estimates say entraps about 27 to 40 million people around the globe. And this is men, women, and children that are most often in forced labor of some sort, which you see a bit of in the Sound of Freedom movie. But of victims of trafficking, about two-thirds of them are victims of sex trafficking. Many of those are women, and about 50% of those are girls or minors of some sort. So this is a massive problem that besets every country in the world, but particularly in the United States. In recent years, the United States has actually become a top destination spot where a majority or many of the victims of sex trafficking in particular are either taken from the United States or brought to the United States. So whereas in the past, sort of the stereotype is that men would travel to a poor Asian country where they could buy sex, oftentimes from a young girl. But now with the way the United States has gone, they don't even have to leave the country. With things like the open southern border, it's actually coming right here to the United States. And then the sad part of child sex trafficking in particular is that the average age that a child enters the U.S. sex trade is around 12 to 14 years old, although there are certainly cases of much younger children being involved. And then on top of that, victims are usually trafficked by someone that they know. So this could be a parent, a neighbor, a family friend, or even someone posing as a romantic partner to this young child. And so they're really, really coming from a relationship of trust where the child thinks that they are safe and can be vulnerable with this person who then takes advantage of that and exploits that in the industry.
Let's just pause on that for a minute, just so I get a clear picture of what we're talking about. And I think this is a good time to say that if you're listening to this in your car while you're driving and you have young ears, it would be good to come back and listen to this program some other time when the children are not present. But going back to that point, where we're talking about the majority of children know the person who traffics them. So when you say trafficking, what exactly does that mean? Because trafficking gives you the image that they were at their house and now they're someplace else. They're being, you know, they're in some kind of traffic that goes somewhere. What exactly is the sort of transaction that we're talking about here?
Yes, and that's an excellent point. So some critics even push back about using the term trafficking to begin with, because trafficking technically does deal with moving persons across state lines or border lines. So child exploitation is even probably a more accurate way to talk about this. So what does this look like? In the Sound of Freedom movie, like we saw on like the global scale, a lot of times this can look like kidnapping a child, selling them to adults, either fully, then those adults will sell them for sex, like rent them for sex, basically. Or it looks like cases in the United States where children are even still living in their parents' home or still living in a foster care home. But on the weekends or at night, a parent or a family member, when they're maybe babysitting the child while the parents are at work, can sell them for sex. And so the sad reality is this could be a part-time thing that the child is being forced to do, or it could be a full-time situation where the child is being sold 5, 10, 15, 20 times a day for about $90 per sexual encounter. Just time and time again, 6 to 7 days a week, really on just like a nonstop spin wheel.
Wow. And so in those situations, do you have any sense of how often it's a relative versus a non-relative who happens to know the family? What do we actually know about the prevalence of different types of situations like that?
It's a great question. So there aren't clear studies that say to what percentage of interactions come from a family member selling them versus a neighbor versus a romantic partner. And in large part, because the child exploitation industry is just so hidden. So there's very little that we know about it. If we were able to find, when we find these victims, that's when the information is logged, but it's not the sort of thing that you can do a survey on to get a good idea. So of the cases that we've find an older man posing as a romantic partner, especially to a girl who's like 12 to 14 years old, is actually a very common entry point. And then I would say parents trafficking their children or a guardian of some sort trafficking their children tends to be the second. And then you also see older aunties or mentors who are pretending to be the child's friend, but are really working for a pimp to get them involved in child sex trafficking.
And so in some of these cases, the child's still living in their family home.
Yes, especially with the rise of social media, that's becoming even more easy to do, because the child is oftentimes just trafficked through a live stream session or through social media. So the child doesn't even have to leave the home for the content to get out to buyers.
So in that case, are we talking about videos of the children? Or are we talking about actual interaction, or sometimes both?
So both. Now, obviously, child pornography is incredibly common. It's, I think, 25 to 35% of all downloads on the internet are child pornography, which when you think about that is a staggering number of all the downloads ever brought off the internet from every single person combined, right? 25 to 35% is pornographic and of children. Wow. In particular. Wow. So it's a massive problem. So in some instances, you are recording. So a trafficker of some sort is recording either videos where they're having sex with the child or forcing the child to do something, or it's uploading pictures of the child. But what we're seeing a lot more in recent years is something they called live stream cyber trafficking. And so with live stream cyber trafficking, you're not actually recording a video and uploading it. You're just having a conversation over a platform like Zoom. Not Zoom in particular, but like Zoom, where people who have the code can pay money and log on and watch exploitive content of a child live. And what's so particularly nefarious about this approach is that it technically avoids laws that prohibit child pornography, because child pornography laws say that downloading or sharing the content is illegal. But if you log onto a live stream, you're not actually downloading it and you're not technically sharing a complete product. And so that's just one of the new ways the technology is actually making the ability to prosecute this crime so much more complicated.
Wow. So this is a kind of I don't know what adjective he used. I was going to say a nice overview. This is a pretty comprehensive overview of the range of ways that this can go on. And so the Sound of Freedom movie, let's talk about that for just a moment. The Sound of Freedom movie, of course, is only talking about one incident. So it obviously can't depict the full range of things that could happen because it's telling us a narrative story about one, you know, one, a limited set of things. Obviously, this is all they can cover. But I'm interested to know, what did you think of the movie, The Sound of Freedom? And what did you think of some of the criticism and pushback that has come to that movie?
So I was a huge fan of the Sound of Freedom movie. I actually, in high school and early college, worked with an anti-human trafficking, specifically sex trafficking organization in Thailand. So I traveled to work with the missionary family there and did not nearly as intense, not even anywhere close to as intense of the work they do in Sound of Freedom, but definitely was going into villages and educating people on the signs to look out for. And so one of the things I really liked about Sound of Freedom is that they managed through a beautiful cinematographic movie to really warn people of many of the common signs of child sex trafficking, especially on the global scale. So the movie begins with a woman who is attractive and builds trust with a young child and promises them a career in modeling. This is incredibly common from the work that I've done and from what others have seen, where a child is either promised a better job in the big city, a modeling contract, or even a religious leader comes and promises the child an opportunity to study in one of the religious institutes. And so they were able to set that up incredibly well. And of course, we know that oftentimes these are just fronts and that the promises that they're offering are not available or true in the slightest. And so I thought the way the movie like really brought that together and made it real was it was so powerful. But I think the thing that I appreciated the most was how prevalent hope was throughout the whole movie. So there were key moments where the actors would pause and smile because they had just won even a very small victory. So getting the millionaire billionaire on board to fund the operation was a huge win for them. And there was a moment of celebration and joy that like they were making progress. There was a time early in the movie when he was able to arrest one of the pedophiles on like massive charges and he smiled. And I think that when you're working with this topic and oftentimes teaching others about it or producing documentaries, it's just incredibly easy for this to be a relentlessly painful and hopeless topic because of how massive the problem is. And it is massive. It's so much bigger and it's so much worse than anything we can even imagine from the stories right. We've heard. But in the middle of that, like, especially as Christians or as someone of faith, like, even as you're dealing with an insurmountable problem, you also were balancing the fact that we do have a good God who has created each of these children, who is sovereign over the world, and who tells us that the work that we don't do in vain, and everything that we do for him and with him will bear fruit. And so I thought the way that they brought in hope that even though the problem is so difficult, that there is good work being done and that there are good people really chipping away at this was just incredibly impressive.
So it's a very grim area. And here at the Ruth Institute, a lot of the things we do are very grim, particularly when you're looking at harms to children, and it can be very demoralizing. And so I think that's true, that it was an important part of the story to see the kind of hope that people had and the kind of little glimmers of grace that they got that would keep them going. The other thing that I noticed was that they depicted very well the grooming process. And the woman that you describe, who's promising these kids everything, you know, in addition to that, the way the first pedophile who got the little boy with him, the way he gave him the little snack and the way he talked to him and your sister will be hurt if you don't do what I say. And, you know, it was stomach churning, really. But on the other hand, very important, I think, for people to see what the grooming process can look like, because good people can be taken in by this, you know, they're very good at it.
Yes, and you're exactly right pointing out the use of threat and coercion. This is huge. So whether it's the threat that a family member or your sibling is going to be hurt if you don't acquiesce, or if you yourself are going to be hurt. And when we know that rates of abuse are incredibly high in the sex industry, period. But another thing that we've really seen, especially with traffickers who were connecting with children online, and this is becoming more and more common for first contact to actually happen through social media rather than in person, is they'll start a conversation. Sometimes they're posing as a young child. So an older man pretending to be a teenage girl asking a boy for a nude photo, something like that. But they'll start with more tame requests that the child might be used to. So like, oh, send me a pretty picture of your face. Oh, you have a beautiful smile. Oh, show me more of your shoulder. Let's go a little lower. And like slowly but surely desensitizing the child until they are sending sexually explicit content or nudes of some sort. And then at that point, oftentimes a trafficker will turn around and say, well, I've got you now. So if you don't want me to send this picture to your school, to your parents, to all of your friends, then you're going to need to keep uploading content, or you're going to need to upload videos of some sort. And they really try to entrap the children such that they think that their life will be over if they don't continue going along with the trafficker. So like that use of threat and coercion is just a huge problem in how they both entrap people and then keep them in the industry.
And it's a combination of rewards and taxes, you know, of luring them, giving them something good with one hand, and then smacking them down with the other hand, and so on. It seems to me, wasn't this, do you remember the story that Nicholas Kristof did in the New York Times a few years ago about young people having their sexually explicit content being on the internet and never getting it down? You know, they could just never get it back down. Do you remember that story?
I do, yes.
Yeah, okay. And this sounds like the same sort of thing, but he was describing something very similar in that.
Yes. Yeah. And this is an ongoing problem across social media platforms. So there's been district cases. One almost went to the Supreme Court, actually, on sexually explicit pictures or videos posted of children on Facebook, on Twitter, I think on Instagram too. And they've had multiple cases dealing with this where children oftentimes had to petition or wait years for content to be brought down. So they're able to say, this is a sexually inappropriate picture of me. I'm a minor. Please take this off your platform. And sometimes it still took Facebook years before they took it down. So this is just a massive problem that really the old lesson of once it's on the internet, it never comes down is just true in this area. But another way that this is really becoming a problem is even with Pornhub or other websites like that, where children, minors will have videos of them uploaded against their will without their knowledge sometimes. And then years later, we'll find out that this video has been open on the internet for years, racking up thousands or millions of views. Wow. And again, the process of getting it down is nearly impossible because why would someone take something down they're making money off of? It's a terrible reality. But yes, his piece was just pointing to like this entire issue.
And so given what you're saying here, that we understand that The Sound of Freedom is a dramatic depiction of a slice of this problem, of this massive problem, what has been your reaction to the reaction to The Sound of Freedom? I found it astonishing, actually, the way in which so many people in the media pushed back against The Sound of Freedom, and in very similar language across the board. What was your reaction to that? What do you think that's all about, Emma?
It's true. It's as if they all had the same talking points they were pulling from. And what's surprising about that is you can go back even a year ago, and many of these same outlets were publishing pieces talking about the harms of child sex trafficking, or talking about how it's a massive problem that we should really get under control. And then all of a sudden, this movie comes out and everyone changes their talking points to the same script. And as everyone knows, the Sound of Freedom is related to QAnon. The Sound of Freedom isn't an accurate depiction of what child trafficking looks like. And this is bad. This is a $150 billion industry. There is more money to be made here than in any other industry, save for arms dealing. And whereas with arms dealing, or even like drugs in particular, right? Like a drug you sell one time, someone uses it one time and that's it. And they point this out in The Sound of Freedom, but with a child, yes. You buy a child one time, you can sell them thousands upon thousands of times. And so the pushback that was so disingenuous across the board really just struck me as really just reinforced how good and how impactful The Sound of Freedom was, because obviously people who want to keep this industry alive and active and out of the sight of normal Americans, they were feeling the threat of people really getting serious and a lot of attention going to this where it hadn't been there in the past. So I take all of the negative reactions actually as a sign that we're winning and that we're making good progress here, because people only yell when you're actually hurting them, right? When you're actually making progress against what they're doing. And that's what it seems like to me.
Yeah, it's like we're over the target. You know, if people are shooting back, we're over the target. And honestly, if they had a little more self-control, they would have been better off just keeping their mouth shut. But the fact that they all squawked in exactly the same words at roughly the same time, yeah. You know, it kind of says, well, why, you guys? I mean, you didn't have to say anything. You didn't have to call any attention to it whatsoever. That kind of is an indictment all by itself. Now, obviously, it's circumstantial evidence. It doesn't prove in a court of law or anything like that. But it's like, inquiring minds want to know why you guys are so keen to trash this thing, you know?
We also know that child sex trafficking, especially in the United States, takes on a very different flavor and can look very different. And so while it's important to, I think like the main way I would say this is that don't assume that The Sound of Freedom is an exhaustive list and that this is what it will look like, because there's lots of other indicators, especially in the United States, that you should be on the lookout for, that your children here are probably more likely to fall victim to. So it's unlikely, I mean, unless you do live in a third world country, it's unlikely that your child will go through the same sort of experience that they do in the movie. But that's okay. The movie is meant to draw attention to one side of it, and the other side we can even talk about now.
Yes. And you know, I heard this from one of the ladies that I've interviewed about the whole pornography question. And she told me that pornographers who are looking for children to use as models or whatever it is, they will approach a child and tell them how pretty they are. And they watch how she reacts. I don't know. Have you ever heard this, Emma? Do you know what I'm going to say next?
Yes. Yeah.
You know, if the girl just says, oh, thank you very much, and it doesn't have much change in her affect, well, she's not much of a target. But if the little girl looks at her feet and kind of goes like this, then the guy knows that nobody's ever said that to her before, and she's ripe, for the picking. Yeah. Is that consistent with what you've seen? Yeah.
Yeah, no, yeah.
So, and it actually happened. My daughter is very tall, and in high school, she's, you know, particularly tall and striking and so on. And she had somebody approach her in the shopping mall and tell her how pretty she was and all this kind of thing, you know? So I was like, there it is, you know, there it is right there. If she had been a little bit less grounded, who knows what could have happened, right? So in your column, you talk about several factors that aggravate sex trafficking. And in that column, you were not so much talking about a little girl's affect or the social media so much. You were talking more about things that are public policy, kind of at that public policy level of things rather than the individual family level of things. Spell out for us what some of the aggravating factors are for the development of the sex traffic.
So the four main factors that I focused on in the article, at least, are the southern border, which is effectively an open southern border right now, social media use, pornography, and then broken families.
Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the pornography connection. Let's talk about some of the other factors. Okay, so let's say that all of a sudden you couldn't get across the border unless you had certain paperwork. I mean, you know, let's say it was harder to get into the country. I don't even know what that would look like exactly. What difference would that make to the sex trafficking trade?
So if it were harder to get across the border, I think that would probably, it would mean that similar to what you saw in The Sound of Freedom, you would have to have a passport or some sort of legitimate or falsified legitimate looking documentation to bring children across the border, or you would have to have a much you would potentially have to have children coming who have relatives in the United States that would have a legitimate tie to really come here. So contrast that with what we have now with the effectively open southern border. So I think as of May and June of this year, there were an average of 435 unaccompanied minors coming to the southern border every day. So that's thousands per month, hundreds of thousands per year. And so one study actually estimated that drug cartels and traffickers will exploit about 60% of these unaccompanied minors. Many times the price that they pay for a trafficker or a cartel to bring them to the border means that once they get into the United States, they have to pay off their debts, working in forced labor, or most commonly in some form of like forced prostitution or sexual exploitation. But then other times, one whistleblower actually in Congress talks about how the way that the United States has set up their policies, that they are engaging, really helping a multi-billion dollar industry flourish. So in another case, there were hundreds of children just released to unrelated adults. Some of these adults spoke a different dialect of Spanish than they did, and already had multiple other unrelated children in their care. And if you know the signs of child sex trafficking, even the ones we've talked about in this episode, you know that 60% or more of those kids are finding themselves in situations where they are being exploited, either in forced prostitution or for child pornography. Maybe not as a full-time gig, but certainly as a part of the payment to get in. And that's just the sad reality of the way the border's working. And I think we've all heard the really sad stories of young girls that have come to the border who show signs of rape from multiple men, even in the last 24 hours alone. Like the open border, far from being a sympathetic way of welcoming people into the United States, like it's often framed as, actually, because of the lack of policies that are being enforced, because of the lack of the rule of law, it's actually just opening the door for more and more children to be exploited and harmed every day. And unless the United States steps up and enforces these policies, at some point you become, you support it, you encourage it by your lack of action.
So I want to just go back to something that you said, because I don't quite understand how it works. So you've got a child who shows up at the border, and then he owes the traffickers money because he pays their fee. How did the child get there in the first place? I mean, a six-year-old doesn't say, hey, I'd like to go to the U.S. and walk up to the Rio Grande. I mean, did some relative put them in that situation? Were they already kidnapped in some way? How did they even get as far as the border?
Yes, it's a great question. So I think you're looking at both scenarios there. On the one hand, if parents want to get their child to the border or cross the border, and maybe there is a parent in the United States that they're going to, or a relative that they're going to, like I think best case scenario, that's what you're hoping for. And so in order to pay the trafficker, maybe they know that there's a chance the child, a very good chance the child will be exploited. And honestly, maybe they don't. In many of these rural areas and third world countries, they probably aren't totally aware of just how awful the process will be and just what the traffickers might force the child to do. So I think a lot of times parents are stuck between a rock and a hard place where they don't have enough money or food to care for the child in their own country, but sending the child to the United States is a risk.
So there are a lot of possible scenarios. This is not a thing where there's one formula that always is playing out. There's a lot of different ways, because if they're trying to do something that's illegal, they're going to have a lot of nooks and crannies and ways of getting that done.
Yeah. And I mean, frankly, the situation is just so out of hand that first policy that we should approach is just to enforce the current laws. But because they're so overrun with the number of people, and because they're not following the policies they initially set up, a lot of times they're taking the kids, they're logging them in the system, but eventually they're having to let them go because they're running out of space to keep them inhumane. Wow. But even just requiring people to come through a central immigration site, apply for status in the United States and receive it rather than just coming and hoping they can sneak through, like that alone would cut down on a lot of this, because you would have to have children formally apply with proper documentation, parental knowledge, and would ostensibly have a much safer process where you're not overrun. You can keep kids long enough to ensure that they're going to good homes and that sort of thing.
Well, it really isn't over this. Just this dimension alone is an overwhelming problem, the way you're laying it out there. Let's talk a little bit about family breakdown, because that's one of the things that you mentioned. And something that I've noticed in interviews with Jeffrey Epstein's victims, many of them emphasized the fact that they preyed on people, that the pimps, his procurers, would prey on kids in foster care and things like that. What are some of the ways that family breakdown feeds into the whole child sex exploitation? Let's call it by that name, child sex exploitation, rather than child trafficking, because exploitation is a broader term. It covers the movement of kids. It covers all sorts of different things. So how does family breakdown feed into the whole problem of child exploitation?
86% of kids who are in some form of child sexual exploitation were at one time in the foster care system. So you're looking at kids.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Say that again from the beginning. Ruthie, do you hear this? Do you hear how awful this is? Okay. Go ahead. I'm ready now.
No, it's horrible. So 86% of child victims of sexual exploitation in the United States were at one time in the foster care system, 86%. What this means is that 86% of children who are being sexually exploited likely don't have a mother or a father who are in a good position to care for them. And so they're removed from their parents' home due to abuse or neglect. And so we know that children who have a past of sexual exploitation are more vulnerable to being caught up in the child sex exploitation industry. And they're more likely to just find themselves in sexually promiscuous relationships to begin with. And then on top of that, children with an unrelated male living in the home, which is a cohabitating boyfriend, it's an uncle. And sometimes in blended families, it's an older brother who's not biologically related to the child. These children are 11 times more likely to be sexually or physically abused. And so these numbers are just staggering. Like, without a doubt, the safest place for a child is in the home with their married biological mother and father. And any other family structure puts children at risk for all kinds of abuse and exploitation, especially sex exploitation today.
So if we just start with that point, you got the foster care system, you've got the cohabiting boyfriend problem, you've got the stepfather, even if they get married, right? So you have a stepfather with perhaps older step-siblings who could end up being problematic. You've got a variety of ways that a child can end up vulnerable. And in some respects, being inside the home with somebody who's exploiting you is, well, I don't want to say it's worse or better. Those kind of comparisons don't really make sense. It has its own set of problems. Let's put it that way, that your mom's husband or your mom's new boyfriend is exploiting you. It means that you can't turn to your mother for help and consolation. Perhaps, right, you try and mom says, oh, that's not really happening. How dare you say that? You know, and so then you have the breakdown of that relationship as well.
Across the board in the United States, 40% of children are born to a single parent. But if you look at minorities like the African American community or the Hispanic community, that percentage jumps to 60 to 70% of children born to a single parent, which means that the likelihood that that mother is going to cohabitate with an unrelated male is insanely high. Last year, the Ohio abortion story where the 10-year-old little girl got an abortion. But the thing that they didn't cover in the news that I think is even more important in this situation is the fact that the mother had her boyfriend living in the home, an unrelated male that she had met and after a few months allowed to live in the home, and who she knew had a past of sexually abusing girls. And so because the mother allowed this unrelated male into the home, it meant that her own daughter was being abused and exploited under her roof and did end up pregnant. So just some of like the most horrendous and heinous instances of abuse coming because of family breakdown directly. And because fathers aren't there to protect their children from these very things.
And, you know, I've about a year, 18 months ago, we interviewed a detective, a guy who spent like 5 years investigating crimes against children, mostly sex crimes against children. And he told the very same sort of thing. You know, he would investigate the case and he would just kind of shake his head at how often he saw the same pattern. You know, lady, listen, this guy is not interested in you. He's interested in your 10-year-old daughter. You know, and of course he can't say that, you know, because that wouldn't be appropriate. But the pattern is just so prevalent, you know, and the mom is more interested in the boyfriend because her life is unstable and she's looking for love. And the child's father, the unity of the mother and the father and the child is not there. So normally your love, mom and dad's love for each other builds up the love for the child. And vice versa, your love for your child builds your love for your spouse. But if there's been a break in that family system, then those relationships are competitive rather than complementary and building on one another. So it's very striking how often this happens. And it's very striking how little the mainstream media pays attention to that aspect of things, you know, because when you think about the policies of the sexual revolution that have led to family breakdown, that have celebrated family breakdown, the fact that they refuse to pay attention to this. You know, in my book, The Sexual State, up here, okay, there's a chapter in there. Well, actually, every section has a chapter on propaganda. But in one of the chapters on propaganda, I point out that there was a period of time. It used to be that certain statistics were recorded by family structure, whether cohabiting versus married, you know, and so on. And at some point in the 1990s, they started pooling those things together as intimate partners. Okay, so domestic violence, for example, it's all intimate partner. Your intimate partner did this to you, but they had to know when they grouped that together that the married couples had lower rates of domestic violence than the cohabiting couples. They had to know that was true. And by lumping them together, they're hiding something. You know, it makes me crazy. Yeah. Sorry. End of rant, but you know what I'm talking about. I'm sure you've seen this in other, you know, in other forms. So let's move on, since we're getting a little bit off the topic of child sex trafficking and child sexual exploitation. I noticed on your page at the Heritage Foundation, you're part of the DeVos Center over there at the Heritage Foundation, which is the wing of Heritage that really works on the social issues. Is that correct? Is that safe to say?
Correct.
And so you have a number of other topics that you work on. Would you just briefly say a few words about some of the other things you work on?
Yes, absolutely. So aside from working on child sex trafficking and issues related to that, I am also building out the Heritage Foundation's bioethics and assisted reproductive technology platform. And so really digging, which is fascinating. And then sort of the way I like to frame it is this is not Bush era bioethics. It is an extension and it's building off of it, right? Because back in the day, we were primarily focused on research on embryos, stem cell research, that sort of thing. And that is certainly still a massive problem that we need to focus on. But just the reality is that with technology, the space for bioethic abuses has just expanded rapidly in the last few years. So some of the issues that I'm particularly working on relate to in vitro fertilization, relate to commercial surrogacy. It relates to infertility laws in the United States, where multiple states have or are trying to redefine infertility to include a person's sexual orientation or their relationship status. And then also looking at the role of technology like artificial intelligence and how that actually warps or can contribute to the perversion of the family and even of the creation of a child. And so one of the things that I like to point out, there's an ethicist whose name is Oliver O'Donovan, and he was writing in the 80s in a book called Begotten or Made about what it means to be human and how that's intimately connected to one's origin story, to one's procreation. And so he points out that in the same way that God beget Christ of the same nature and same substance, so parents beget their children of the same nature and substance. But in scripture, it says that God created man and woman, which means that while God was the source of their life, man and woman are of a different nature and a different substance than God is. And so then Oliver O'Donovan points to the use of assisted reproductive technology and the ways that we're really testing or editing children and rapidly really kind of designing or customizing them based on the desires of adults. And he says, what happens when parents are no longer conceiving or procreating their children, but instead are making them and designing them in a lab? Are we actually creating a child that is unlike us? Instead of begetting children, parents are now making children, such that you're potentially redefining even what it means to be a human. And so this is just a fascinating industry that I've really gotten into, looking at the difference between procreation, which speaks to this mysterious conception of life, to the use of reproduction now, which really talks, really speaks to this machine-like conveyor belt making of children. And so I've done a lot of research looking into this area because similar to child trafficking, one of the major abuses within the assisted reproductive industry is baby selling. This is a common problem that just last week there were multiple busts related to baby selling. And so the way I like to frame this is, say a single man wants to create a child, and in most states he has the legal right to do so. After a man buys an egg from a donor, pays an IVF lab to create an embryo, rents the womb of a woman for a surrogate to carry and birth the child, and then pays her, there's not much of a difference between a legitimate fertility contract and just outright baby selling, because he's effectively paid for the entire process to create a child that he's hopefully related to, but maybe only partially related to. But when it comes to commercial surrogacy and when it comes to genetic testing of embryos, so testing for the sex of the child or even the hair color, eye color, skin color, there are no laws governing this. So the United States might not have as many abortions based on the sex of the child as they do in other countries. But the fact that 75% of fertility clinics offer genetic testing where you can see the sex of your child and then choose the embryo with the sex that you want suggests that we actually do have sex-based abortions. They're just happening in the fertility clinics rather than at the local Planned Parenthood.
Right, right. This area is, this is very powerful what you just said, and I didn't want to interrupt you, but about 15 things jumped my mind when you were talking. But I want to go back to Oliver O'Donovan, because what you said about him there, I want to just draw it out, because I've thought about this quite a bit, because we had an infertility experience, you know, way back in the 80s, and we did not do anything fancy for a number of reasons. We didn't do anything fancy, and I'm glad that we didn't. But I do know what the pain of infertility is like. You know, I'm not naive about that. But I thought what you were going to say, and tell me if this is right, is that when the parents are not begetting, when the parents start making, then they are elevating themselves into the role of the creator, and the child is somehow of a lower substance. Is that right? Is that where you were going with that? Yeah, yeah. And the other thing that occurs to me is we in the Catholic world, I don't know what your religion is, but in the Catholic world, we talk a lot about self-donation and self-gift, and that the gift of self is part of what the marital act is supposed to be. The marital act, the marital embrace, is the full, complete gift of yourself to your spouse. Well, and then we have this euphemistic language of sperm donor or egg donor. Well, they're not donating a darn thing. They're selling, right? Right. So right there, it's a different kind of transaction. But they're taking that gamete out of the whole context of the whole self. When I donate myself to my husband, I'm donating my body for the gestation of the baby. I'm donating my whole family history that my child is now going to be connected to. I'm giving him my whole future because we're going to raise that child together. You know, it's the transaction at the fertility clinic is like a joke, right, in comparison with the full marital gift of self. Right. And O'Donovan was talking about this stuff in the 80s.
Right after the first successful case of in vitro fertilization. Many people, I think, are just not even aware of what all goes into the process. Children are meant to be received as a gift, right? Whether they have Down syndrome or whether they have some sort of issue or not, they're a gift that you receive And sometimes they're a gift that you don't. So Psalm 127 and Psalm 128 talk about how children are a heritage of the Lord and the fruit of the womb from that. But even in like very difficult circumstances, I think like even when there is infertility, like it forces us to go back to scripture and go back to God and say, okay, God, like you were the giver of life. What is it that you were doing here? Right. But with technology and with the way this industry is working, instead of parents really positioning themselves as created beings of God and going to their father saying, okay, father, like we would like to also like engage in this. We'd like to have kids. Instead, they can turn to technology. And rather than children being a gift that they receive, children become an act of the will and they act upon parts of the body. Right.
Yes. Yes. It's an total willfulness. It's total willfulness. Right. And that's why when people will say, you don't understand, what they really mean is you don't understand how badly I want it, right. You know, and okay, I do, you know, yeah. I mean, actually I do have some understanding of how badly you want it. But the point is the strength of your desire has no moral relevance whatsoever. Right. It doesn't matter whether you just really want the baby or you really, really, really want the baby. It doesn't matter. That's not the point. The point is that the baby is a gift from God. You are a gift from God. Your whole existence is a gift from God. In that sense, the child and the parent must be equal. You know, I mean, that's a profound kind of equality. And I don't know if you've had this kind of conversation, Emma, but I've talked with any number of donor conceived persons over the years. And some of the conversations are really hair-raising, you know, in the sense that they have the sense that they are their parents' project. And if they don't turn out right, that they've failed, you know, in some way.
Well, and going back to what we were saying about the importance of the family and how devastating a broken family is, when you're dealing with a donor-conceived person whose parents either purchased the sperm or purchased the egg, that means that that child has a biological parent that, especially if it's an anonymous donation, that child has a biological parent that from conception, they've been severed from altogether. Right. And so not you individually, but if you are doing this, then you are choosing to keep your child from knowing who their biological parent is. And we know how devastating that is. And so I think you've probably read a lot of the studies that I have that Harvard University has done talking with donor conceived persons. And one of the things that you consistently hear is that they feel like they don't know who they are because they don't know their heritage. They don't know where they come from. And where you come from is such a huge part of understanding who you are today and your role in the world. And so not being able to even point back and say, oh, that's my grandfather. That's my great grandfather. They came from Ireland 100 years ago, right? That's a profound impact on a child and on his or her development in a way that I don't think that we've really, policy-wise, we certainly haven't taken the time to consider that. But then on the other end of the spectrum, there have been multiple documentaries and even some policies that have been put forward to address the presence of donor fraud. So what happens when a doctor is using sperm, but instead uses his own sperm, right? And this is happening a lot. And the gross thing is that the moment this technology was made available, doctors or people started abusing it. So some of the victims who are coming forward of donor fraud are 30 or 40 years old, basically as old as in vitro fertilization itself is. And so it's just a good lesson that when technology enables something, the fallenness of man, the corruption of man is going to find ways to abuse it right away, which is why we shouldn't be using technologies that we don't understand, that we don't have proper guardrails on. Because if not, you're just opening the door for more hurt and more hurt at the most intimate level of a person's conception.
Right, right. You know, earlier in this conversation, I forget where it was, but you said something about what it means to be human. And I really think that's what's at stake in pretty much the whole of the sexual revolution. I think that modern man, modern woman, we have the idea that, and I'm speaking now as an economist, okay, that we're like bundles of impulses, we're bundles of desires, and the purpose of a person, your goal in life, is to satisfy your impulses. And that's in a way how we taught economics. I mean, we didn't say it like that, but you know, you have your utility function, and that tells you your preferences. And the object is to maximize your utility, you know, and get as much as you can with the resources on hand, you know. And you never ask, well, gee, are those preferences worth having, or where do those preferences come from, you know? So, but that view of the human person, I think, is profoundly incorrect. Right. And I'm taking it on by saying, as an economist, I was part of that. I was part of teaching that. But I think it really comes into play here when you see the reproductive technology industry and understand people who are really drunk deeply from the economics well see nothing wrong with it because it's satisfying a consumer desire. Right. And they haven't asked the question, is this really a humane desire? Is this really, can we honestly say that we're maximizing our utility without hurting anyone else? The only way we say that is by ignoring a certain class of hurts. You know, we can't even let ourselves see them. So I think the question of our time really is, what does it mean to be human? And who are we? You know, what does it mean to be human? How are we going to make ourselves happy? And can we make ourselves happy? Or is there something else, someone else who's supposed to help us with this whole thing, you know? And so many of the issues that you've talked about here really, really touch on that point. Seem to me you have some other issues that you work on at the Heritage Foundation. So we've covered the child sex trafficking. We've covered the reproductive technology thing. And by the way, I'm more radical than you are. I would abolish the whole thing. But anyway, it seems to me there were a couple of other things that you work on over there as well.
Yeah. And so then in addition to that, when I first came on at Heritage, the Dobbs decision came out where Roe v. Wade and Casey v. Planned Parenthood were overturned. And so it really was all hands on deck in DC. So yeah. I helped with the life issue for really the next 6 to 8 months, doing everything from federal to state level, working with policymakers on that issue. And then I also work really dealing with like the cultural aspects of marriage and of motherhood in particular. I think with sort of the theme of like child sexual exploitation of assisted reproductive technology. Like you're saying, the consistent theme is what it means to be human. And since the sexual revolution, I think one of the primary aspects of being human, of being a woman, right, is to become a mother. A literal mother through childbirth, a figurative mother through the relationships that you have, really embodying Mother Mary and like the image of the church and what it means to be human. But that's also one of the top areas that's just been under attack. So there's a Life magazine article from 1972 where it's talking about the Rockefellers funding of an entire study with the explicit goal of reducing the number of children that a woman has. And so mm-hmm. they say, well, we're having too many kids. We need to just have fewer kids. So if every married woman, you know, just had like half a kid less, then we would solve the population problem, right? Which ended up not being a population problem at all. And so what they advocated for was birth control for everyone. So I work a lot on birth control, especially over-the-counter birth control and how harmful that is to women. They said we need abortions available on demand for any woman who needs them. And I'm sure you know and have talked about plenty that the more prevalent birth control is, the more prevalent abortions are, because people become very sloppy in the decisions that they make rather than really reflecting and considering, is this someone that I want to give myself to? Is this someone I want to have a child with? They treat it like, yeah, it's a very laissez-faire event. And then they
right. end up
child, then they're like, oh, actually, I didn't want a kid with you. And so then the request for abortions increases, right? But then they also advocated for things that I'm not suggesting are a bad idea, but they were like, oh, well, in order for women to be less interested in motherhood, we should remove home ec classes from high schools. Let's not teach women about how to care for their home, how to love the home, how to use the home as a place of industry and a place of life. And like you were saying earlier, with sort of like the economic transactions that sort of took over the way we think about these things, instead of the home being the home economy, right? As it was defined in Greek, the home became this landing pad of leisure, this place that after you go and productive out in the world, after you go and do the things that really matter, you can all come back to the house and like eat a quick meal or watch Netflix on the couch, you go to bed and then you leave the home to do good work again. But really the home itself was just this hollow shell. And again, part of that was taking out home ec classes that really taught people to value the home. And then the last one was they encouraged higher education. So if you can get women perpetually in education, which again, I'm not saying it's a bad idea. I actually think it's great, right? But if you use that as a replacement for motherhood, then it becomes a little problematic. And so what are one of the top majors for women today? Gender studies. So women are pushing off motherhood. They've abandoned the home. And instead they spend their time in academia discussing gender studies, which I think you and I can agree, you probably learn a lot more about gender studies just being in a family than you do sitting in a classroom. But all that to say, like, it was a very intentional, crafted plan to reduce the number of mothers we have in the United States. And now for the millennial generation, you will have about 25% of millennial women who will never have children by choice, not due to infertility, but by choice. This is the highest number we've seen in any generation. So really reframing the conversation around motherhood is something that I'm very passionate about, both on the cultural level, but also when it comes to policies, because the Equal Rights Amendment would really erase the differences between the sexes, making them interchangeable in a very, very problematic sense.
Oh, golly, you're singing my song, girl. You know, honestly, when I started the Ruth Institute in 2008, that's what I thought I was going to talk about. You know, I wanted to tell women, you don't have to wait until you've made partner in the law firm or you've made tenure in order to start your family. You can start your family sometime before menopause and it will be okay, you know. And that's what I thought I was going to do. And in 2008 in San Diego, Proposition 8 happened and I couldn't sit it out. I couldn't sit on the sidelines while that went on. And so I got involved in that and that steered the whole Ruth Institute in a very particular way. But I wanted to come back to that Life magazine article about the Rockefellers. I really want you to send that to me. Okay. I'm very interested in that. And I will tell you why. John D. Rockefeller III was the kind of the father of population control in the United States. He was the guy who's going around beating the drum, saying we got too many people, yada, 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 spent a lot of his own money, you know, doing different things to deal with population control. And in my reading of that, in 1974, and this is in my book also, in 1974, he gave a speech at his population congress in Bucharest, I think it was. And he stopped talking about population control and started talking about women's empowerment, because by 1974, he had definitely figured out that he could get 90% of what he wanted without ever creeping people out by saying population control, because that was creeping people out. White, black, and brown people were weirded out by this guy saying there's too many people. Emma, this has been a really fascinating conversation. We've gone well over our time. I think what we're going to do is divide this and have two sessions and have you know, something special for our premium viewers, because this has been extremely fascinating. And I wish you all the very best in all of your work over there at the Heritage Foundation. Do you have a newsletter or some routine way that people can hear from you or find out about what you're working on?
So as of right now, the best way to keep up with my work would be through Twitter at EMLWaters. And then otherwise, if you go to the Heritage Foundation under staff, you can see a list of my articles there. Or if you go to the Independent Women's Forum under my staff page there, I also have a number of publications there as well.
So Emma Waters, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show. This has been a very fascinating conversation, very thought-provoking. We, I'm sure, are stimulating many conversations among people on topics that they didn't necessarily want to get into, but I think that are important for people to get into. So I really appreciate your time. Thank you for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
Thank you. I enjoyed it.